Maybe you've been hearing about the intelligent query processing capabilities related to feedback in SQL Server 2022 and Azure SQL. But have you seen all of them in action? In this episode, we will dive into a ton of demos so you can see all the benefits of memory grant feedback, degree of parallelism feedback, and cardinality estimation feedback this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined once again by Kate Smith, a PM on the SQL team. Kate, thanks so much for coming back on the show.
Absolutely. I love being here, Anna. Thank you.
We love to have you. And today's a super exciting episode because we are doing demos of performance for our IQP feedback-related capabilities. So we're just going to kind of go for it. And I think the first one we're going to talk about is related to memory grants. So I'll pass it to you. Let's take a look.
All right. Let's have a look at memory grant feedback. Okay. So here's my demo. I've got SQL Server 2022, or the latest version with Compat 160 installed. And basically, I'm going to demonstrate the, in the databases, worldwide importers, I'm going to demonstrate sort of an oscillation situation. This is where percentile grant feedback really buys you a ton, because what we do is when a stored procedure has a lot of variation in the values given to it as parameters, it can create a problem situation for memory grant feedback. So I've created a stored procedure, and let's look at the actual counts for each. For example, we've got 200,000 values, whereas bag, we only have like 1,000, right? So if we execute this stored procedure first for bag, right, it's going to actually give us a warning that we gave it an excessive grant. That's because this value for bag is below the average for the overall in the table. But then when we execute with each and we look at the execution plan, what we're going to see how it took so long. This sort, it had to spill the disk, right? We see here, it spilled disk to disk during execution. That's really painful. But if we go back and we execute with bag again, we no longer get that warning that we gave it excessive grant because we've already learned and adapted, right? And so if we alternate back and forth a few times, so here we did the sort, it still spilled the disk, but it's going to start spilling less and less as we adjust and adapt. So let's see how we did this time. Still spilling. Let's execute with bag. This always executes quickly. No warnings. Everything's happy. Let's go back. It takes a few times, right? Because remember, we're learning. We're adapting on the fly. So it can't just happen like automatically. But now, look, we've gotten to this point where we no longer spill the disk. How cool is that? Like, we've learned, we've adjusted over the period of execution. What before wouldn't happen that way. And now, like, let's look at query store hints. So query store hints is one way in which feedback features can provide insights into what it's doing, but memory grant feedback is not one such feature. So you won't see query store hints showing up for memory grant feedback, but the planned feedback table will show, hey, look, we generated memory grant feedback, we needed additional memory, and we validated it. That's really cool, right? So now we've just on the fly learned how much memory your query needs, adjusted so that not just based on the prior execution, but on a history of execution, and we're doing the right thing.
Wow, that's pretty cool. So just to make sure I understand what happened here is like, it's taking like, it's tallying like, okay, we ran like this and it, you know, we spilled the disk, it ran like this and we used too much memory. And so is it at a new value that's not each or bag? Like, what would it do?
It will adjust. So like, or even if your data changes or your execution patterns change over time, it will adjust. So it'll sort of like record history for a while and like adjust on that. But temporality is taken into account so that like, let's say you require this amount of memory and you execute for a while and things are good. And then a new value gets added that's like not each, but it's like by piece or something, right? I don't know what would be more individual. And that has a lot more values. We would, over time, we would learn and we would adjust up, or similarly, we could adjust down if the way that you execute the query, the usage patterns change.
Nice. That is super cool. Okay, we're moving right along because I know there's a bunch here. Like, what's the next one?
Cardinality estimation feedback. I'm going to only show you one of the three model variants that we support with cardinality estimation feedback. But I hope that it'll be really insightful and you'll learn a lot from this, just this one. All right, let's go to it. Like I said, CE feedback demo, we're going to talk about correlation. So we've got three different models of correlation when you include CE feedback in our product, right? We've got the default, which is sort of partial correlation or exponential backoff. We've got, I'm just going to talk over all the setup work that I'm doing to set up the query store, make sure I've got the database installed, et cetera. We've also got it fully independent. So if you've got conjunctive predicates like A and B, then we can actually look at when they're correlated or when they're not. So I've set up an X event session here, and we're going to watch that data live on that X event session while we execute our query, so we can see what CE feedback is doing in real time. So here again, I said we've got two predicates, where state province ID is 79 and city equals remit. Remember, this conjunctive predicates in a where clause. Are these correlated? Are they independent? Or are they partially correlated? Right. So we're going to run the query a number of times. And CE feedback only works for repeated queries. So it's not going to take place for every ad hoc query that you do. It's a lot of analysis to do for every single little ad hoc query to make this work correctly. So we execute it. And then we're just going to flush the plan and all that information to the query store so that we can look at the query plan that was executed. So we bring it up here by doing a query against query store. We get the show plan and we can just look at it here. And you see, we just did a scan of a table with this where clause involved. But as you can see, is that we estimated 44 rows, but we actually got 121. What that means is that the data is more correlated than we originally expected, because we assume some level of correlation, and completely correlated data is going to be more rows. Because we'll just take the one predicate that was the most selective and use that instead of incorporating data from or information from other predicates. And here we do get a hint and says assume min selectivity. That hint means that we take that minimum selectivity predicate and we use that for the whole thing. So like, let's say Redmond was more selective than the state, right? We would just use the selectivity generated for that one predicate. And so then before we persist this, we validate it. Does it make a difference? So first, let's look at how we did in practice. All right, we're bang on, right? We went from thinking we were going to get like 44 rows to actually the actual number that we got, which is 121. But if we look at the validation, and this is really interesting, and this is why this is such a fun demo for me to show, is that the plan hash didn't change. So we didn't change the plan. And because of that, we actually default the original CPU time to zero so that the feedback will not be persisted. So the original time wasn't zero in practice, but we assumed that it was as a way of preventing this feedback from being persisted. We only want to persist feedback that is of high value. And if we're not changing the plan, maybe we're not doing enough for your query. Does that make sense?
Yeah, super interesting. Clever.
Well, we can run it one more time. And we can see here, we're back to the old way, right? We reverted that feedback. So we really operate on a do no harm, right? A do no harm principle. And so we reverted that feedback and we're not going to provide it. So normally CE feedback would show up in this query store hints table, but it's not there because we actually reverted the feedback. You can also see in query store plan feedback, CE feedback tried to do something. Right. It provided no hint. That's why that feedback hints is empty. And we just said we regressed the verification. We did not persist it. So should we have a record that we tried something and that we removed it from the hints? We don't actually want to keep it. And that's how CE feedback works.
Gotcha. Okay. So then just that last part, I didn't quite understand. So why did we regress it? And was that a good thing?
So it is a good thing in the sense that, like, we didn't make the query run slower, right? Our estimate got better, but we didn't change the plan, right? And if you look at this from a holistic view of query optimization, right, the whole point of making these adjustments is to get better plans, right? Better plans, better performance. But right. In this situation, it's really focused on better plans. And if you aren't changing the plan, that model variant doesn't do enough to make a difference for your overall workload. It's still the same plan. Our estimate's right, but the way the query executes didn't change.
Okay, got it. So that makes a ton more sense.
When we could bring in other things that could do more, right?
Right, right. Yep, makes sense. Okay, cool. So we got memory grant feedback, cardinality estimation feedback. I think we got one more.
We got one more. You ready for degree of parallelism feedback?
Yeah.
All right, let's do it. Yes, so degree of parallelism feedback is super interesting. Here we have a stored procedure we've executed with a parallel operator. And you can see in the plan properties, we had 32 degrees of parallelism. This is actually a synopsis, a time lapse, if you will, of running this same query over and over again with degree of parallelism feedback turned on. And you can see that the degree of parallelism went down, started the query feedback was 32. We suggested 20. We tried it with 20. We verify, we validate three times between each and every new adjustment. Yeah.
That's so cool.
I know, right? Like we just validate. And then eventually we get to stabilization. And notice we're not going down in big leaps. We're just going down 32, 20, 16, 12. We actually tried 8. If you saw that there, we tried 8 and then we went back. And you can even look in query store plan feedback. We were just looking at this for CE feedback. And wow, look at this. Not only did the degree of parallelism feedback kick in, but so did memory grant feedback, which is really cool. The same query is getting both of these. All these features work together. They don't work in isolation. So they all work together, which is like a great, I don't know, it's like a symphony. I love it so much. But you can see in degree of parallelism, we had a last good feedback of 12. So now we can even look at the statistics of this query running over time, right? We started out with a longer duration. And as we decreased the parallelism, we actually got faster. That's that parallelism efficiency concept I'm talking about. Less parallelism is faster. You can see it here too when we look at just CPU time. We're just getting faster and faster. And then we kind of stabilize, right? And that stabilization point where the data points kind of level out, that's parallel efficiency.
Wow, that's super cool. I think the first view that you showed where it was like, oh, we're at 20, now 16, now 12, and we're kind of going to stay there and see if it's stable. And then we're going to try 8. And then, oh, 8 doesn't really give us much. So we go back to 12.
Again, the do no harm principle is really critical for these features, right? We really try to make sure that what we're doing is positively impacting. Because we're learning just from your workload, trying with just this one query, right? Like, we just really work hard to make sure that it's all positive, all good. Right. Oh, I got it. So here's the deal is degree of parallelism feedback, right? That works for every single query in your workload, right? So imagine being a DBA and trying to find that perfect parallel efficiency point for every single query in your workload. Yeah. That sounds overwhelming, right? But instead we'll just do it, which is pretty cool.
No, this is awesome. Kate, I can't thank you enough. I learned so much and it was so cool to see all these things in action. I feel like I learned a lot more by seeing how they actually work and seeing it in reality versus, seeing it on a slide. So Kate, thanks so much for coming on, sharing these awesome demos with us. To our viewers, we'll put some links in the description so you can learn more about these feedback capabilities, how it can just help you run faster. If you like this episode, give it a like, leave us a comment, and let us know what you think. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.